The science goes forward when there is a cross-fertilization. If you remain within the cocoon of your specialty, you do not really do much in science. You require cross-fertilization so that the medical people should be talking with the chemist, with the physics people, mathematics people, then only you can have science. So I would love to have cross-fertilization with this institute as well. Now we are talking about gut microbiota. Look at this Indian science. I am referring to here Charaka Sanghita. There were two great doctors in India. One was Charaka. He was a medicine fellow. He was a physician. And there was a Susruta who was a surgeon. So there is a book of Charaka called Charaka Sanghita. And what did he write? He wrote in pre-2nd century CE. You can imagine how old it is. That he said human being is a microcosmic replica of the universe. Dr. Taligudar was referring to. And he said three humors, vayu or gas, pitta or bile, kapha or mucus are responsible for most ailment. So he said all diseases begin in the GI tract. Now today in 2019, the world is revisiting what was said in India long ago. What does it mean? We Indian failed. Our scientists were great, but we remain too complacent with what we have, rather than going forward and actually letting the world know what India is. When I go to the Asia, I realize how great Buddhadeva was. He came from Bihar, then went to the whole Asia, and he actually led the whole Asia. We can't even lead today our own country, what to talk about Asia. So we have to actually recapitulate what we had and go forward further. Also from the West, Hippocrates said, all disease begin in the gut. Now let me tell you, if you look at the gut microbiota, in human being we have 10 to the power 13 human cells. But we have 10 to the power 14 bacterial cells. So the our number of our own cell is much less than the number of bacterial cell we have. Interestingly, I am talking about bacteria because bacteria can be easily sequenced by 16S RNA gene sequencing. But I am not talking about the fungi. Fungi require 18S RNA gene sequencing, which is more difficult. And I am not talking about the viruses, because the viruses are most difficult to work with in the gut. So therefore, when I am talking about that we have 10 to the power 14 bacterial cell, we have 10 to the power 13 human cell, I am referring to only bacterial cell. But we will know more about the fungi and the viruses in time to come. So maybe one of you should get into fungal story of the human gut and maybe viruses. Now these include archaebacteria, fungi, and many even protozoa, like eukaryotes, like protozoa. Now they are living in our body, and I am referring to only gut. I am not talking about the respiratory tract. This has enormous number of bacteria. I am not talking about the genital tract, which again has enormous number of bacteria. So I am referring to gut only, because the gut is the one which is more known, and I have a bias towards gut because I am a gastroenterologist. Now, what is dysbiosis? Now, look at this bacteria. The predominant bacteria are gram-positive firmicutes. I'll tell you what are these firmicutes. And gram-negative bacteroid constitute 20-40%. So firmicutes are 60-80%. Bacteroids are 20-40%. So what happens is within the gut, you have friendly bacteria. Most of the firmicutes are good ones. They are friendly. And you have bad bacteria, some of the bacteroids are bad. And we, the physician, understand the ratio of good and bad. It is like in a country, you have a lot of good people, a very few bad people, your country become good. On the other hand, if the reverse is the case, then your country become bad. Similarly, in the gut, you have more good, less bad, you are healthy, but when the ratio changes, you develop diseases. Now, these are talking about phyla, and the species. Firmicutes include lactobacillus, I have not put the whole species name because of the lack of space. There are multiple lactobacilli species. Enterococcus, so I have put here genus, Staphylo, Strepto, and Clostridia. They are mostly good ones. Bacteroids include Bacteroidetes. There are so many Bacteroidetes. And Prevotella. We have also Actinobacteria such as Bifidobacteria and Gardnerella. And we have Proteobacteria such as Vibrio, Escherichia, and Shigella. So now we refer to dysbiosis. Dys means bad. And biosis means we are referring to microbial environment. What is dysbiosis? Dysbiosis means your gut has developed a state where there is abnormal microbiota. What is abnormal? Abnormal means quality has changed. You have more bad bacteria than good bacteria. Or the quantity has changed. There is enormous number of bacteria. The bacteria has to be kept within a control. Like population explosion kills a country. Similarly, bacterial number going up is called bacterial overgrowth, is bad, is associated with diseases. And third is bacteria in an abnormal location. For example, there are some bacteria which are anaerobic. They are supposed to be in the colon. Colon means large bowel, large intestine. Large intestine is like our toilets, whereas small intestine is like our kitchen. In the kitchen, food is processed, so it should not be dirty. But the toilet, we defecate. But suppose if all those colonic bacteria come to the small bowel, it is bad. Because if your toilet comes to the kitchen, obviously it is bad. So this is dysbiosis. Dysbiosis means bacteria in excess number, bacteria in an abnormal location, and bacteria is an abnormal quality. Now look at this. This is the human gut. And in the human gut, you have to understand, the upper gut is relatively sterile. You know why? Upper gut is our kitchen. So we do not want a competitor such as bacteria eating away our food. So that's why nature has made the upper gut like small intestine and stomach relatively sterile. So that's why you look at the number of bacteria. It is 10 to the power 0 to 10 to the power 1 in the stomach, 10 to the power 0 to 10 to the power 3 in the small intestine. Look at the colon, 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 12. So in the large intestine, I'm talking about the large intestine. So in the large intestine, you have 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 12. So you have number of bacteria more as you go down. And look at the type of the bacteria. We know stomach has a lot of acid. Why this acid is important? This is hydrochloric acid. If you put that hydrochloric acid into your skin, you'll really have burning there. It's so bad. Now this acid is required to digest the food that we are eating. But then, can the bacteria grow? Bacteria can't normally grow. But those bacteria which has evolved to tolerate acid, they grow. Which are the one? Lactobacillus. Lactobacillus ferment milk, make curd, and make it acidic because there is lactic acid in the curd. So they love little bit weak acid. So that's why they live in the stomach. Second is Helicobacter pylori. Helicobacter pylori does not love acid. In fact, if you grow in a culture plate Helicobacter pylori, and if the plate pH is acidic, it can't grow. But what it has is, it liberates urease. And what urease does is, that urease breaks the urea into ammonia, so that around the bacteria it makes a neutral or alkaline environment. And then, it swims through the acid of the stomach and buries behind or beneath the mucus layer, which is neutral. So that's why in the upper gut, you have lactobacillus, you have helicobacter. Those are the one either love acid or withstand acid. And Dr. Talukdar was referring to pursuing a question. I know one of, he is very friendly to me. I've met him several times. His name is Barry Marshall. Barry Marshall did PhD under a pathologist whose name was Robin Warren. And Barry Marshall said, I'm a very average guy, you know. I chose Robin Warren because what happened is I went to many guides and they said, what PhD will you do? So everybody refused in Royal Perth in University to take me. And Robin Warren used to believe, those old guy, old pathologist used to believe that human stomach has bacteria, and everybody used to laugh at him. Said, pH is 1.5. Can bacteria survive there? This fellow is mad. So one of the fellow whom he approached for PhD, he said, go to that guy, Robin Warren. He will take anybody and everybody, provided you say that I believe stomach may have bacteria. And he said, I really told that, and he embraced me, and he took me into PhD. And they found out Helicobacter pylori is there in the stomach. Barry even cultured Helicobacter pylori, okay? And then he took Helicobacter pylori himself, he swallowed it, caused gastritis in stomach, underwent endoscopy, and later they got Nobel Prize, okay? So what happens is, pursuing a question is very important. Now, these bacteria perform multiple functions. Because it is a busy chart, I will not show you now, but when I keep on speaking, I'll refer to one after another. Now, we have been studying this gut bacteria for last 20 years. About a decade before, whole world was became mad about this gut microbiota. We're sitting in the corner of Lucknow, SGPGI. And what we used to do is that we used to believe that there are a lot of GI diseases where bacteria are important, gut bacteria. So we used to study quantitative increase in the bacteria of the jejunum. This is called small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. So looking at small intestinal bacterial overgrowth in the patient of GI diseases. So what happens is we even invented a catheter. Why this catheter? Because what we do is we put in an endoscope. This is the endoscope. The endoscope goes down to the duodenum or jejunum, which is the upper small bowel. Then you put a tube through the endoscope and aspirate. But what is the problem there? The tube is going to take the content of the endoscope channel, because the endoscope channel has traversed this area. And this area we know have a lot of bacteria, particularly pneumococcus and H. influenza. If you study the gut, gut doesn't have H. influenza, gut doesn't have pneumococcus, but this area has. So when we are actually putting a simple catheter, we are getting H. influenza and pneumococcus, and we said there is no reason why H. influenza should be there and pneumococcus should be there. Then we realized that we are going through the endoscope. The endoscope has gone through the pharynx, so why should it not have? So therefore, we developed a technology which is a double lumen catheter. Can you see this? This is the catheter which is bigger in diameter. This is another catheter which is narrower in diameter. And the outer catheter is blocked by an obturator, so that when it is going through the endoscope, it is not getting the nasopharyngeal content. And now what you do is that this inner catheter has a lot of opening in the side as well as in the tip. And then once you have reached the duodenum or jejunum, you push the inner catheter, which is longer than the outer catheter. It dislodges this obturator, and now the inner catheter will aspirate. So this is the technology that we have developed. And then what you do is that you take the aspirate, do a serial dilution, and you see at what particular dilution I can count the number of colonies and mathematically calculate if this is the number of colonies in this dilution, what will be the number of colonies in the neat aspirate. Now, using the same technology, Brisbane Gerald Holman recently developed a catheter. What he did is, we are talking about the luminal microbes, because when I aspirate the luminal content. But remember one thing, now whole world is mad about fecal microbiota, and they are saying gut microbiota. This is absolutely, absolutely non-acceptable. Fecal microbiota is not gut microbiota, because fecal microbiota is one which we are pushing out every day. But who are residing there is more important than those who are pushed out every day. But why people are studying fecal microbiota? In the West, it is very difficult to get human study done. So particularly invasive thing. The feces is very easy to take, very easy to obtain. That's why they are doing fecal microbiota. From India, we expect more and more studies on jejunal microbiota and mucosal microbiota. Because if you know, the bacteria has particular character, like cholera. Cholera beautifully swims inside the fluid. They don't adhere. If you look at cholera culture, they are all the time moving around. They don't like to adhere to anything. Whereas look at enteroadhesive E. coli. What they do is that they adhere to the wall and they don't go to the lumen. So therefore, if you take only fecal microbiota, you will only get the luminal microbiota, not get mucosal microbiota. Similarly, if you are doing fecal microbiota, you will get large intestinal microbiota, that to left side, and not jejunal microbiota. So they are different in different places. So what they did is, this Brisbane group, they developed a catheter of similar technology where they use a biopsy forceps so that you can cut the mucosa and study the mucosal microbiota. Okay? So mucosal microbiota is different than the luminal microbiota. Now, what is the problem of this culture technique? Culture technique has a problem. 30% of bacteria are culturable. So if you take the gut aspirate, only you culture 30% of the bacteria, 70% you don't know anything. So this technology came in just a decade ago. What is this technology? This is 16S RNA gene sequencing. So bacteria, they evolved over time. But there's an evolutionarily conserved region called 16S RNA. So this 16S RNA is there in every bacteria. It is conserved. If it is a bacteria, it has to have 16S RNA. If it is a fungus, it has to have 18S RNA. Now, only thing is, you will say, if it is conserved, how do I say which is E. coli, which is Pseudomonas? You say, because within this 16S RNA conserved region, you have a variable region called V1 to V9. These V1 to V9 differ in different bacteria. So looking at the sequence of V1 to V9, we can say that this is Pseudomonas, this is E. coli, this is bacteroides, and so on. In fact, to reduce the cost, we typically sequence V3 and V4. Because if you reduce the number of region, your cost decreases. So V3, V4 is enough, but again, if you do the sequencing of whole V1 to V9, obviously it may be better. And the sample could be fecal, could be upper gut fluid, could be mucosal biopsy. And I tell you that we have to study all this because things are quite different in different samples. Now, how can you study this? We can study it by real-time PCR.